We're going to go ahead and start the question and answer session. The first question is, do you have any specific suggestions for anyone in the audience trying to encourage active and informed involvement of communities in understanding and mitigating their flood risk?
Well, Ben, maybe I will kick this piece off. I think one of the most important things that we have found is really going and having a conversation and developing a common understanding. Say you're a state and coming into a local community, developing a common understanding of their priorities, their geography, their conditions, so that any efforts to understand and communicate risk are tied to those local values. Also important to think about creative ways to solicit input from the public. We've had some communities say that just simply having a public meeting results in a lot of the same folks coming again and again, but you don't necessarily build your audience further. And so a combination of using web-based tools, social media, going to different events where you can have those one-on-one conversations is important in addition to your standard public hearing process.
I'll just throw in my two cents is to, maybe as an idea, to build a really diverse group of people that want to come together and work on the problem. And this, what comes to mind is a story where we actually got involved with a really diverse group of local, state, and federal stakeholders, and the local housing authority was actually the one who brought the greatest kind of diverse ideas and involvement to the group. So kind of think outside the box and develop a really broad group of stakeholders at a lot of different levels of the government, because they bring different resources and insight to the table.
Great, thank you for those answers. Our next question is for Marie. Is there a tutorial on how to use the flood inundation mapper available online?
There is, actually. So in my handout, the slide right after I ended has a link to the webpage for the whole program on there. And if you click on the toolbox and then click to Outreach and Resources, that's where you'll find additional slides, a link to the fact sheet, some posters, some other information. And at the very bottom, there is actually a walkthrough that can take you through the whole application. And obviously, if anybody has any questions, I'm happy to provide demos and presentations and or connect you with your local USGS office that can do the same.
Great, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Our next question is, are forecasted flood extents available for download from the USGS Flood Inundation Mapper?
Yeah, so that's kind of a loaded question. Very good, whoever asked it. So forecasted flood extents just mean that in the flood libraries that both the USGS and the Weather Service have developed, you just need to choose the modeled scenario that matches the future. So yes, if you're in a community that happens to have a flood inundation map library that's live online, there are about 200 between the two federal agencies. And download, yes, you can download all of the geospatial layers if you want to use them in your own application by community from either the USGS or the Weather Service website. The USGS also offers web services if you would like to build those into your own mapping application as well. So download's kind of a loose question these days. And feel free to contact me if you have a specific thing that you're looking for, and I can help with that.
Okay, wonderful. On to the next question. This is a long one. The National Flood Insurance Program paid in excess of $500 million as a result of Hurricane Matthew. Since having flood insurance is such an important source of funding for recovery purposes, and since the information presented here can be very helpful in portraying specific information on flood loss potential, is there any formal program for sharing this kind of information with companies writing flood insurance? And I know Maria can't be with us, but perhaps either of you could speak to that quickly.
Yeah, I can. Or Ian, do you want to take a stab at it?
Sure, I'll speak, at least for the Colorado perspective. I know this doesn't necessarily help with Matthew, but our State Department of Natural Resources, our lead for both floodplain mapping and for the National Flood Insurance Program, has a tremendous amount of information available. Likewise, there's the floodsmart.gov website for FEMA in terms of the National Flood Insurance Program, and then any number of other federal agencies, which Maria, perhaps you can touch on.
Yeah, so you hit the FloodSmart one, which is definitely a great place to start. And sharing this information with companies writing flood insurance is really broad because those insurance providers are commonly going to be local. So that falls down to a local interest. But I encourage floodplain managers to contact FEMA. And also the USGS provides, for specifically for Hurricane Matthew, I worked on the USGS response for it. And we collected over 1,000 pieces of information, high water marks, and sensor data and tide gauges, and we're in the process of actually producing a flood documentation study for, I believe, 8 or 9 communities in North Carolina that were specifically affected by Matthew. We work closely in partnership with FEMA on those flood documentation studies, and those will be released to the public. You can download them. And then we would hope that those get trickled to the companies writing flood insurance, but that's kind of outside of the scope of my federal boundaries.
And one last piece that I will add is oftentimes your local hazard mitigation plan will have very good information about flood loss potential. I know our Department of Public Safety and the Emergency Management Agency at the state does a great job with their local partners of trying to integrate that information and put it in a digestible format. And of course, those plans vary across the country, but they can be very helpful.
Okay, great. Thank you for those answers. We'll move on to question 5. Which is, to what extent does your work incorporate any impacts of climate change on flood frequency or magnitude? And if so, what challenges are associated with any of these kinds of efforts?
You want me to take that one, Ian?
Sure. Why don't you start and then I'll jump in after you.
Perfect. So this is a really great question and one that's very important to how these flood inundation maps were created and how they're used. So research shows that climate change will affect frequency and magnitude, but it does not necessarily directly immediately affect the landscape. So if you produce a map that says it's going to flood this area at, say, 10 feet of stage, for example, that's not necessarily going to change because that's what 10 feet looks like on the landscape unless you change a bridge or have a blowout flood with your levee, et cetera. But given all physical conditions staying the same, how often 10 feet occurs is very different, and that you might hit 20 feet in that you have never hit before. So we are encouraging groups to do deterministic mapping because it is a little bit more robust. When you see that a 20-foot flood is coming twice as often, you can just go get that map out of the library. Probabilistic flows, you don't have as many maps to choose from necessarily. And as those probabilities are shifting and changing and there's a greater uncertainty with those, as we see a lot of the changes that we have had in the last few years, that makes understanding the changes in frequency and magnitude kind of compounded together. So I would recommend looking towards flood documentation maps and deterministic flood mapping to try and develop products that can be used across the spectrum of what we may or may not see in the climate changes in the future.
Well, and it all depends on the context of where you are within the country as well. Our partners, both at state government and federal partners and academia, have taken a look at climate conditions, how they're changing, and what that potentially means for Colorado. And they've got a lot of great information in some of the studies that have come out about temperature shifts, maybe earlier snowpack, the potential for drought being more intense than it has in the past. What we don't have yet is enough granularity on data to incorporate that into flood frequency or magnitude calculations. What we do know is that both, again, the climate is changing and population is growing, so that means we need to take a more frequent look at what our risk is, get the most recent land use, land cover data, and also understand what those changes could look like, but actually turning that into a map of any reliability is probably still a little ways out, but we're certainly looking into that quite a bit right now.
Yep, agreed with all of that business.
Great, thanks both of you. We'll move on to the next question, which is for Ian. Has Colorado established elevation standards for infrastructure protection? And if so, do they apply it to all infrastructure?
That is a great question. And if you go to our Colorado Water Conservation Board's website, you can just Google Colorado Water Conservation Board. They do have published floodplain rules and regulations. And what those rules and regulations include is a freeboard standard of 2 feet for critical facilities, and within the rules they define those critical facilities, and 1 foot of freeboard for all other development. So the way the rules worked is communities around the state had to adopt them into their own codes. That was the rules were passed in 2010, actually before our floods, and that adoption continued through right till about the time the floods happened. But that is a higher standard, and that was a great process that the Water Conservation Board did go through to put those together. One little piece that I'll add to that is we are also trying to consider things like transportation and the environment in its context. And I mentioned the and our rivers in the steep mountain canyons. And just a simple freeboard standard may or may not make sense, but thinking about the dynamics between the river system itself and how to have a healthy ecosystem, hydrology and flows, as well as have a strong transportation corridor, something that we're looking at in the recovery context and now in a pre-disaster context as well.
Great, thank you so much for that, Ian. Well, we're just up on the hour here, so that's about all we have time for today. If you have any questions that you haven't asked during the webinar and weren't addressed today, you can email them to us at cipinfo@americangeosciences.org, and we'll make sure to send your questions along to the speakers. We will be posting today's recorded webinar on our Critical Issues webinar page soon. The URL is right up on the screen. You can visit the website to view this webinar, as well as previous ones, on a wide variety of geoscience topics. Thank you very much to Marie and Ian for sharing your time, expertise, and insight. And thank you to Maria, even though she can't be here. I'm sure she will be getting back to you, to many of you, with your questions, with lots of interesting and useful answers about what they've been doing in South Carolina. This concludes our webinar for today. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you next time.